Vin.
I'm Sori.
That's Booey.
And Jelpy and Ghosty.
Quarantine Chronicles, bitches. that's the mini series that we're doing.
Yep.
Completely original. I got my little brother on the camera, and then we've got Sori. It's starring Sori and our family. So it is the cinematic event of 2020, ladies and gents.
People are like, so how do we get this? Oh, we're going to put out the first episode for free for
everybody. First one's going to be for free, and then the second one is going to be at the $5 tier on Patreon. So, there you are. Or, if you don't want to do Patreon, you can do Vin and Sori.
You can do it through PayPal.
PayPal, vinandsorimerch@gmail.com. Like I said, it's the cinematic event of the year. Anyway, for timely topical political commentary, not tiny topical, timely topical, ignorant fools. For timely topical political commentary, you can hit us up at Middle America with Vin and Sori. This is a selection from our Patreon alliance called the Epic Underground.
Yep, that was their intro video that you saw when you started this video.
Shout out to the big homie Drew Legiri. This is melodic death metal. If you, dear listener, would like to be part of an alliance, it's very, very simple. $1 at the gate at Patreon, and then you get sucked into the Borg, as it were. Shout out to all of our... Are we still doing that roll with the
Patreon? Yeah, the Patreon, at the end of every video.
Patreon roll.
Yep.
Shout out to all our brand new patrons, the folks that turned up yesterday. So, Gary Bois, Zach... Jeff, Jenny, J-Bro, horns
thanks,
up to
guys.
All you guys, thanks. On a serious note, if you have been on Patreon for the last couple months and you forgot that you're on Patreon, you should really reassess financially if you can stay on Patreon because, I mean, of our current situation. So I know this is kind of like counterproductive, but think through your budget and there's nothing wrong with jumping off Patreon for a month or two or forever. If you're in a bad financial crunch. Mm-hmm. If you are, she's going to murder me for this. If you are and you jump off for a month or two, we'll still let you stay in your alliance, okay? Because, you know, I mean, come on.
I have no problem with that.
Okay.
If you knew some of the things I did, you'd probably be surprised.
Okay, good. All right. So here we are. Lost to apathy, dark tranquility. Let's go.
All right, ready? Go.
Oh,
first started, I was like, nah. And then they got like, wow, what do they call this?
This is Melodic Death. I think you like Melodic Death.
Yes.
Remember that band that we saw?
Melodic Death Metal, of course.
It wasn't Behemoth. It might have been the Behemoth show. I think it was the Behemoth show. But you really, really loved the band, and they were a melodic death metal band. Pretty certain it was the Behemoth show. SubhanAllah. This actually, there was a lot of wisdom in this song, actually. This wasn't just like a regular I'm complaining about my life song. Like, there's a lot of wisdom in here if you can figure out what he's saying, inshallah. Huh. So,
well,
yeah.
I'm glad you figured it out so you can enlighten the rest of us.
Well, I mean, what he's saying, you know?
Yeah, I don't know what he's saying.
Well, okay, so the name of the song is Lost to Apathy, mm-hmm. which is really interesting, because the name of the album is called Character. The name of the album is called Character, which is very interesting, because maybe it's talking about, like, different aspects of people's character, but one of them is apathy, and I think this song explores why people go into apathy. And then what happens when you're an apathetic, you know, Mother Teresa's got that quote that the opposite of love isn't hate, it's apathy. Which is very, very brilliant deduction of the human condition.
I think that when you're in a situation like she was, it's very, very easy to see that.
Yeah, although, yeah. Mother Teresa is like a saint with an asterisk. She's like Barry Bonds, you know, Barry Bonds took all the steroids.
Why?
Well, one of them was like, there were situations where she could have relieved people's suffering, but she didn't relieve it because she thought that suffering built character and all this stuff.
Oh my gosh.
She had like a dark night of the soul for like 20 years consecutively, which dark night of the soul is not supposed to last for 20 years. So there are some things about her that's kind of like, but she had some great quotes, and so that was one of them.
And
so
she used to take the worst of the shoes that would come in the barrels, didn't she? Or is that a...
Yeah, because she had a very big primer on suffering. So she didn't exempt herself from suffering either, but she didn't necessarily go out of her way to relieve the suffering as much as she could have. But, you know, anyway, I'm not going to make a cheeseburger out of that sacred cow.
See, that's why Jesus talks about motivations behind what we do in the heart.
Yeah.
Because taking the worst shoe out of the pile because you love the other people and want the best for them is different than saying, I need to suffer more than... You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's totally, wow, interesting.
I mean, theology matters. Yep. Theology has consequences.
Starting one of our underground shows over there.
No, that's a main stage.
That was a main stage, yep.
My brother's here, and so, you know, there's nothing you can do about it.
It's his baby brother, so we gotta just let him slide.
He gets away with everything just like when we were growing up. The unsaid tone of weak despair fails to resonate. Frayed end of our binding thread will disintegrate. By the laws of our physics stage, failure to communicate. So I think this is like their relationship. And the frayed ends of our binding thread will disintegrate.
Yikes.
So the last things that were holding them together are gone. And it's ultimately due to...
Communication!
Failure to communicate!
Well,
so we talk about this a lot in our relationship.
We do.
Yeah, I you know, that's the number one thing, man, in every relationship. It's about communication. You have to communicate. But I think there's some like topics in relationships where like there isn't the action that follows through with the communication, or maybe there isn't the hope that the thing is going to change, so they just don't talk about it. Or maybe it's a fear of conflict.
Yeah.
So they don't talk about it, and so...
And I think some of it, too, is a fear of being misunderstood. Like, sometimes you try to communicate something, and then it gets misunderstood, and then you say to yourself, I should just never said anything to begin with.
Yeah.
Because...
Yeah, yeah.
Things are now worse.
That's a... Yeah. I mean, it depends on how you define success.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, like... I don't have a problem with something getting temporarily worse, because in my opinion, in relationships, nothing gets worse. You just discover where things actually are. So a person could say, oh, that's getting worse. But to me, it's like, no, that's where things actually were outside of all the pretense. So that's just my perspective on it. I don't think things get worse in relationships. if communication is constant. If it's not constant, then yeah, it definitely leads to the disintegration of what does he call it? The binding thread. Yeah. This guy, well, he can write. And a lot of these guys, English isn't their first language. Let me see. What's this guy's name? Michael Stani? See? Swedish melodic death metal band, Dark Tranquility. So, like, all these guys came from Sweden. What was the other one? In Flames, they're also a Swedish band. Who? Him? They're Swedish, too?
Pretty sure.
Him was the very beautiful brother. That the guy that looked like, what does he call it? Twilight?
Oh, really? Boyfriend? He did?
You know, the guy who took off his shirt, took off his shirt, he was all glowing.
He was a
shit.
Kid. He was a kid, Vin.
We're communicating. None too sentient. Hear no, see no, worthless magic. Against all function, ongoing choices. The trials will
this
end.
This guy?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
None too sentient. Hear no, see no, worthless magic. Against all function, ongoing choices. The trials will end. Filter the nonsense and laugh at what's left. Indecision, non-vision. What matters, taken away. So to be sentient means to be self-aware and aware of your surrounding.
Yeah.
He's saying, hear no, see no worthless magic. And it's usually hear no evil, see no evil.
Mm-hmm.
So worthless magic might be talking about prayer. Like if you're coming at it from the perspective that, you know.
I guess it, yeah.
You know what I mean? But there's a lot of people are saying that right now. Like I put something up on coronavirus cases going down. And I said, you know, wash your hands, a little bit of social distancing, a little bit of faith, we're going to be all right. And of course somebody, well, what has faith done for you? And some people just don't know when to turn it off. But at the same time, when people are in a situation like this and then there's a lot of fear, people without faith resent people that do have faith.
Well, yeah.
Because, you know, it's like the reaction that, you know, when you were reading Psalm 91 or whatever, and people were like, you know.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people liked it, though.
A lot of people did, but a lot of, and the vast majority of the feedback from the post I made was very, very positive. Mm-hmm. But then you have people that are just like,
But there's always some people,
There's almost like this resentment of people.
Like, you didn't have to listen to it.
Yeah, there's almost this resentment of people who have faith in situations like this.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, like, some of it is like those church, like I personally believe that those churches that are like, screw you, we're gonna go meet anyway, and we're gonna have 1,000 people get together, and you know, like 50 of them have coronavirus now. Like, I think that's terrible, and I can understand why people would say, you know, look at this foolishness. But at the same time, like, there does seem to be like that sort of latent resentment of people that have faith and trust in God.
That dare to try.
Yeah, and I, you know, I had a conversation with somebody, a good friend of mine.
It's funny because they're gonna go after them for having the faith to try to meet, and then they're gonna go after the faith groups that are shut down because of the coronavirus.
Oh,
you're screwed if you do.
Right. Yeah, they're like, oh, I guess.
Oh, you shut down because you're faith.
Yeah. And then the other ones that do show up, they're like, uh-huh.
Oh. Yeah. There's always something to
That's
say.
That's why I always say, like, if you're predisposed to not believe something, you're gonna take everything you see as evidence to buttress your non-belief.
Like, right, exactly.
That's a completely different discussion, but anyway, none too sentient. So maybe he's saying you're praying to a being that's not even sentient because he doesn't exist. Hear no, see no, worthless magic against all function. Ongoing choices, the trials will end. Filter the nonsense, laugh what's left, indecision, non-vision, what matters taken away. So maybe this is talking about like the moment when you lose faith in religion and then you become apathetic to that too, right? Maybe. I'm just doing worthless magic.
Wow, if that's what it is, filter the nonsense and laugh at what's left.
Yeah.
Because all your life was built on faith.
Right.
And so when you get rid of it, get rid of the nonsense, you laugh at what's left because there's like, there is nothing here.
Of course, everybody's life is built on faith.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as I was talking about in the last fireside we had, where, you know, there's knowledge and then there's certainty.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something in between the gap of knowledge and certainty, because there are actually very few things that you can be certain of. You know, the famous question, how do you know you're not a brain in a vat?
Mm-hmm.
How do you know that you're not actually in the Matrix, especially mm-hmm. when you have serious people now talking about, you know, the whole hologram theory that we're in a, you know, that we're in a...
Yeah.
So how can you definitively know that anything around you is real? Well, you cannot know for certain. But at the same time, we do know that we have actual knowledge of facts, of data. So what's in between the gap between knowledge and certainty, and that's what I call faith. Faith is what's in the gap between knowledge and certainty.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If you've ever been on a plane, that is an exercise in faith. You're taking the knowledge that you have, you're making logical deductions unconsciously. You're saying,
yep.
Look, if this guy
all day every day.
If this guy was a clown or something like that, they wouldn't put this multi-million dollar machine in his hands in the lives of all these people. And
right.
Like, if you start asking questions when you're 30,000 feet in the air and I say, how do you know that this wing is operative? Like, do you know how many, like, things have to go right?
Yeah.
The maintenance guy, the
you to make
this,
it back,
the that. Yeah. You have faith that there's not a terrorist on the plane, which, why do you believe that? How do you know? Mm-hmm. So, and it's the same thing I say about, like, relationships. Relationships require faith, and that's why when a person violates that, they're called being unfaithful. Mm-hmm. You cannot have certainty that that person's going to stay true to you, but you have faith in them. And
right.
if you want right. to live in a world, if you want to live in a world where there's no faith at all, then there's very little things that you will be able to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know no, it's true.
You have
it's
to put all your true. Water through a water filter and then test it, make sure it's not poison. You can't be in a relationship with anybody because...
Where are you going to get your food? You got to trust all the people at the store and
right,
the
right,
distributors.
Right.
And
right. Faith is just a matter of existing in a world where you're not omniscient.
You can't gas up your car because you don't know if there's something besides gas in
You don't know. All you can do is make a logical deduction and hope for the best,
right.
inshallah.
But
I don't think people have, like, thought that far ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that people think that there's only one group of people that have faith and that they're the ones that are mm-hmm. doing things based on reality or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think people have, like, you know, thought that all the way through. But I do think, I have run into people that have lost, like, religious faith or whatever. And I don't know if it's fair to say that they become apathetic people.
That's what I was thinking.
I know a lot of people that, it's weird because I don't, like a lot of people in our community, especially the atheist or agnostic ones that I'm close to, didn't tell me like I was very, very religious and that I, you know, it just seems like they've been atheist the whole time or agnostic the whole time. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't.
Peter, hit me up. I don't know. I'm not sure.
Because I feel like you can get lost to apathy within your religion.
Well, I was going to say, I've seen way more apathetic
yeah.
people. I've seen way more religious apathetic people
yeah.
than, as a matter of fact, the Satanists and the atheists are actually...
They seem more passionate, more...
I'm very, very passionate
very
about...
Weak.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And well, the other thing that's interesting is they seem more passionate about spirituality mm-hmm. than at least the ones that mm-hmm. I know.
Yeah. So that's the
interesting
thought.
Yeah,
that's why I was like,
well. Yeah, but I don't know. Maybe he's just talking about his own experience. I think, you know, Europe as a whole.
But I guess it depends.
Post-Christian Europe as a whole, though, seems to just be apathetic as a whole.
I guess, like, what you're saying, like, if you are just, you know, completely deep in your religion, and then all of a sudden you, like, come out of that, and you're like, that none of that was whatever, and you put so much into it, like, maybe it would make you feel like, I just can't put that much energy into anything else right now.
Yeah.
I don't know, you know.
Well, I've been in situations where, like, I was grinding hard for the cause and for the, you know, movement or whatever. And I was like, you know, I had to decide between my family and that. Mm-hmm. So obviously I took my family. But I've never been apathetic about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Which I think is, you know, I think is a lot. I think that that creates apathetic religious people is that when it becomes about, like, doing things or... hitting
yeah.
a certain standard or maintaining
yep.
a certain standard or whatever, and it's not about that visceral sort of connection to a person.
Yeah.
That for in God's grace, I've always had.
Yeah.
You know,
that's
and I've never had a conscious moment where that wasn't there
mm-hmm.
in my life. And so, but oh yeah, there's been tons of times I'm like, I'm done with religion or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But then you've got this one person who kind of like stalks you.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, that's been my experience. Chorus, look at the shell that is you. Empty, fragile, and weak. Soon the battle is over, lost to apathy.
Where did I chuckle that?
Well, yeah, I was just repeating the chorus again. But, like, it's interesting. It says battle, which means that the guy or the girl was fighting.
Mm-hmm.
But they lost to apathy, which is a mm-hmm. pretty brilliant way of talking about
yeah.
it. Which... I wonder, like, have you ever gone through a phase where you're apathetic? when I first met you, you were kind of like, you were angry. You seemed like an angry person.
Yeah.
You weren't necessarily apathetic, I don't think.
I think I'm more apathetic now.
To what?
Like, to the Christianity that I've known all my life. I'm kind of like, like, I'm not apathetic. Like, when you said I'm not apathetic toward Jesus, I'm with you on that. I'm not apathetic toward Jesus. I know exactly what I think of Jesus.
Uh-huh.
You know, for, you know, and, you know, it's basically all, it's all good stuff, you know what I mean, what I think about Jesus.
Even though you disagree with some of his
Even
decisions.
Though I disagree with a few of his some things.
He was so hilarious.
But,
I disagree with some of Jesus' decisions. All right.
But I just think that, I don't know. But there's just some stuff that I'm kind of like, I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. That's a thing. And I have these conversations with myself all the time, and I'm trying to figure out. But I really think that the interactions that I had with religious people during a super, super important time of my life where I needed them, I think that that has made me apathetic toward that whole scene.
Yeah. I mean, I feel the exact same way about that scene as I did before. Like, literally the exact
yeah,
same.
Yeah, but I didn't see it like that. I didn't see... Like, I think I fell for the hype.
Well, it's not about falling for the hype. I just think it's just human nature. You know, like, just...
Yeah.
To me, I just... It's human beings.
Yeah.
People are, you know... Like I always say, you know, I'm very rarely surprised by people, and you know, that nobody acted outside of their character. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, if you put too much trust in human beings, then you're liable to become apathetic to them. That's the funny thing.
Yeah, I'm like, anytime I see something positive that people do, I'm like, wow, that was unexpected. Good for you.
Well, I don't have that. I don't have the mentality either. I expect people to do a lot of positive things.
No. I expect that, like, out, like in the community that we're in now, in the village, like, when they do stuff, I'm like, that's great. I just, wow, that's amazing. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not like, wow, that was unexpected. But, like, when it's Christian people and they do something that's, like, you know, they squeaked open that wallet to, like, stuff like that. I'm like, oh, that's good. That's good that you helped that homeless guy. Of course, you recorded it and put it on Facebook, but mashallah. I don't know what to tell you, babe. Yeah, I have still a bad attitude
about
it.
Well, I don't think that's not apathy. That's cynicism.
Okay, well then I'm...
So you're not... You're cynical, but you're not apathetic because that's definitely an emotional
response. Yeah, that's
true. Response,
that's,
you know?
True.
So that's good.
I'm not lost apathy.
But I think from a societal perspective, like, that's one of the byproducts of being in a 24/7 news cycle. Is that you're exposed to all this horrible trauma, and so as a defense mechanism, people just like switch into apathy because they can't deal with it anymore. So you hear another school shooting or another random shooting,
yeah.
And people just go, yeah, you know, yeah. And then if somebody's affected by it, like really affected by it, they're like, what's wrong with you? So, and I don't think people are bad for that. I mean, I don't, human beings were not designed to be able to ingest all of that evil.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah. No, I. Yeah.
So I don't think it makes a person a bad person. At some level, you know, people, you know, kind of shut down because, you know, make you want to jump off a bridge. I mean, it's horrible stuff. You see all this, you know. I'm trying to ban you from Facebook for a while.
I know. And you know what? I keep thinking that I'm gonna stop, and then I went on again today.
Yeah, that's the other.
And
thing.
And it was like literally just like what a 1 second click. And then I saw somebody jumping out of a building.
Well, yeah, and
I was like, why?
You didn't have to watch that.
No, I stopped it. I didn't know what was happening.
I know what video you're talking about.
I didn't see the person. Like, I just saw them. Like, once I realized what was happening, I flicked the screen. I'm like,
yeah,
oh, what?
Yeah, somebody.
But it was still so sad to see the.
Yeah, somebody posted that, and it was about. All I'm saying is you don't have to watch everything that people put.
I didn't
in front
watch
of you.
It.
I'm not talking about you per se. Well, you did watch it.
I didn't know what it was.
Yeah, I know.
And then once I realized what it was, I stopped watching it.
Yeah. I tried to tell her, but she wouldn't listen. But just on a real,
just having.
On a serious note, though, like, just because something's in front of you doesn't mean you have to watch it. You cannot watch those things, you know. So,
you can stop searching for those things.
Well, yeah, but you know, people are. So we're inundated. Well, we're inundated with all these horrible things, and so people become apathetic as a course of life. Me. I specifically choose not to look at those things so that I don't fall into that defense mechanism and become apathetic. Like, somebody put it on, and I saw, she basically said, this is due to the coronavirus, people are losing their minds, and I was watching it for 20 seconds, and I thought to myself, something very bad is going to happen. And I always tell based on, like, what the emojis are. So there's like four shock emojis and three crying emojis, and I'm like, yeah, I put two and two together. I'm like, yeah, I'm done. I'm not watching this. And I don't think those are things we need to share either. Hmm. There's reasons that, you know, the news doesn't share things like that in that graphic of detail. You know,
everybody's got a phone.
We are the media.
Yeah.
And so now you got to hold yourself accountable to not repost stuff like that. And not participate in watching it, you know. Because at the end of the day, you know, it's the algorithm game.
Yeah.
It's the algorithm game. So, you know. Sure. But yeah, I've tried to tell you not to watch that stuff, but you never listen to me. I've become apathetic in giving you.
Stop.
Middle part was gangster. This is a 9.4 to me. Really, really.
Yeah.
Good.
Actually, I was gonna go with a 9.6.
Really, really, really good one.
Is that melodic? That's what pushed over the edge.
Yeah, yeah. I like Swedish melodic death metal, man. Good one. Good one, Drew. Good one.
It wasn't just Drew.
Yeah, but he's a leader. He represents
with
everybody. The whole crew. Federal headship.
Then out. With my rap? Sorry.
Gone.
Yeah, my bad. The hymn is finished.
Oh, it's still going.
Oh, don't
we're finished.
Don't worry about it. We'll hear about it in the comments.
Yeah.